Hi, thank you for joining me. Today I want to talk to you about a project I released a few months ago called xlivebg. It's a live wallpaper system for X11, and the idea behind my talk today is not necessarily to give you a full demonstration of xlivebg and its wallpapers or whatever, but rather I wanted to focus on the technical aspects, on the implementation details behind xlivebg, and in general, how do you implement live wallpapers under X11? But first of all, what do I mean by live wallpapers? The idea is that instead of having just a static image as your desktop wallpaper, you'd have something that animates, something that moves in the background. The inspiration came from Android, which has this feature for many years now. And while I'm not necessarily sure that it's a good idea to have something like that on a mobile device with a limited battery capacity, because necessarily if you have something animate on the desktop instead of just a static image, it's going to use more power. But for a desktop computer, if it's handled in a good way, if it's not too distracting and it's something that subtly moves in the background, I think it's quite a nice thing to have. And I've been enjoying it for the past year or so that I have been developing this system. And actually, let me show you how my desktop looks right now, so you can get a better idea. So basically, okay, so this is a live wallpaper using my xlivebg system. I'm going to show you a bit more and a few more live wallpapers that xlivebg comes with at the end of this talk. But for now, it's just something that moves on the background and I have my windows or whatever in the foreground. Alright, so let's get back to the talk. Right, so a couple of things about the X-Window system before we move on. I'm not going to go into a lot of details here, but the main point is that we have the X server, which is the central part of the X window system, and everything else, all the other programs that you're running under X11, are X clients. The X server handles the display and the input devices like mouse and keyboard or whatever, and the X clients connect to the X server in order to display their user interface to that display, and also to get input from the user. And you have such clients as a terminal, a clock, a web browser, an editor, whatever. But most importantly, for our discussion today, the window manager itself, which is the part of the X window system that you, the client that you would use to handle your interactions with Windows and your desktop or whatever, is actually just simple X client. It's not something some special program with special privileges or special mechanisms for managing the windows. It's just another X client, and this is a very powerful notion because it makes it very easy to switch window managers and completely change how you use your computer. Each window manager is free to implement a completely different user interface experience. But at the same time, this introduces some complications, let's say, for programs like this one, like xlivebg, which have to interact with the window manager, because the window manager is generally the program that handles what goes on your desktop, right? So your desktop wallpaper usually is handled by the window manager, not necessarily, but usually. And in order to be able to consistently show something that animates on your desktop wallpaper, you have to talk to the window manager. You have to go through mechanisms that are managed by the window manager. And the problem is that since each window manager is free to operate in a completely different way, there isn't necessarily a single way to figure out how to draw to the desktop wallpaper. And there are a number of conventions when it comes to interacting with window managers, and the word convention is the key here. So there are a number of conventions, like the Interclient Communications Conventions Manual, which was established a long time ago, about how to instruct the window manager that, let's say, right, so I'm creating a window and I want my window to be, let's say, borderless, or I want it to be a full screen window. or a foreground or whatever. Or I want my window to have such and such pixmap as an icon. All these things, for all these things, you need to communicate to the window manager what you needed to do. And ICCPM defines some mechanisms that are agreed upon, let's say, between many window managers and the rest of the X clients. And the thing is that for other things, ICCPM does not necessarily include everything under the sun that you would want to communicate to the window manager. And some conventions are window manager specific. And nowadays there is another set of protocols called NetWM, which handles a wide array of tasks that are not necessarily covered by the ICCM, and it's generally agreed upon by most window managers. Anyway, let's not belabor the point. So, okay, so we want to have an animated desktop. How do we go about doing that under X11? Obviously, something, and that something is going to be an X client, needs to continuously draw on the desktop, whatever that means. And side note here, since it's going to be drawing continuously, it needs to be fast and efficient. That's a very important point, because otherwise it's going to waste your CPU time and make everything, I don't know, sluggish or whatever. And we must keep the redraw rate to a minimum. Necessarily, it needs to draw continuously, but not necessarily as fast as possible. It's best to keep keep the update rate as low as possible while still being able to present the effect that that you want to show on the desktop. So, what's the most efficient way to draw at this point in time on our modern computers? It's going to be something that utilizes the power of the GPU you have in your computer, and that's the simplest way to do that is through OpenGL. So the central point here is that we want to be able to create an OpenGL context and bind it to the desktop and draw through OpenGL our animated wallpaper. What is that desktop though? And here's the sticking point. So a first attempt to create an OpenGL context on the desktop is to use the root window. A root window is actually a part of the X server itself. The X server creates a window that covers every display completely, and that is the root window. And the root window is, by definition, if you consider a hierarchy of windows, a parent-child relationship, if you please, of windows on your screen, the root window is always the parent of everything, the root of the hierarchy. So if some client creates a window like this this green one in this example, generally what you want to do is ask for the X window system to create a window and specify that you want your window to be a child of the root window. That's the usual case, right? And however, there is the window manager that intercepts this window creation thing and interposes its own window, which contains the frame and the title bar and the minimize buttons or whatever else it needs, between the root window and the client window. So the client window is basically changed to have the window manager frame as its parent, and the window manager frame itself has the root window as its parent. So, okay, so a first attempt would be to ask the X window system to give you the ID of the root window, create an OpenGL context for that window, and use that. Unfortunately, that doesn't necessarily work every time, because some window managers create something that's called a virtual root window, and the reason they do that is that because they want to be able to manage the desktop wallpaper, for instance, or they want to be able to create multiple windows stacked on top of the root window, one of which will be showing the desktop. The icons you have on your desktop. Another one will be showing the desktop wallpaper or whatever. And all these are children of the root window. And the window manager frame goes after those, and the client window goes after the window manager frame. So a second attempt is to figure out which is the virtual root window and draw into that. Create an OpenGL context bound to that window. And the way to do that, ideally, in an ideal world, is an agreed protocol in the NetWM protocols, in the NetWM family of protocols, that a window manager which utilizes virtual root windows should set a property on the actual root window called __net_virtual_roots, which contains a list of the windows it has created that cover the screen and are going to act as virtual roots. And so that's the second attempt. We can find out which are the virtual roots and bind OpenGL contexts to those. And I'm talking plural here because obviously you might have multiple screens, multiple monitors or whatever, and then there might be multiple root windows or not. It's up to the window manager. Unfortunately, that doesn't necessarily work either, because many window managers and many desktop environments, well, I don't know if it's many desktop environments, but some desktop environments do not follow those protocols. So they create virtual root windows, but they do not set the correct properties for us to find them. So what do we do? Attempt number three is to just give up and see who else is doing something like that out there. And it turns out there was a program called X-Penguins that was written a long time ago. And the idea behind that was that when you run it, there would be little penguins parachuting through the screen and walking on top of your windows. And in order to do that, actually, X-Penguins did exactly that. Wanted to be able to find the root window or the virtual root window and draw into that. It wasn't using OpenGL at the time, it was using regular X-drawing calls, but it's pretty much the same thing. So, thankfully, there's a lot of free software out there, and taking a look through the X-Penguins code, I found that it has a big function called toNGetRootWindow. And the idea behind this function is that it has lots of special cases. It tries to find the virtual root through the proper properties or whatever, but it also has a lot of special cases for specific desktop environments and window managers which do not follow the properties correctly. And it has special code there that knows that this specific window manager or this specific desktop environment creates a virtual root which is the second of the hierarchy and third behind the window manager frames or whatever. And it has some heuristics there to find the correct window to draw on. So that looks promising. Unfortunately, it's also not 100% correct, because the problem with X-Penguins is that it has been written a long time ago, as I said, and some of those not quite conforming desktops have changed over time. So the heuristics that X-Penguins utilized do not necessarily work 100% of the time. So then really give up. That's another way to do it. And for those desktops that the regular methods and the X-Penguins function or whatever doesn't find the correct window, give an option to the user to create a new window and use some other NetWM properties to signal to the window manager that this new window we intended to be a desktop window. And the desktop window means something that is behind every other X client and behind the icons, right? So fortunately, while I used to have some trouble with KDE with the original, the first attempts, by setting those properties to a new window, KDE, and I think also GNOME needs that as well, KDE and GNOME respect that window type desktop property and properly show my new window behind everything else. So that's something that, but it's up to the user. I could at some point figure out a way to add more more special cases into the X-Penguins code to handle that, to handle the new versions of GNOME and KDE or whatever, but at the moment I've left it up to the user. If the user runs xlivebg and sees a black screen, they have the option to pass the -n n parameter to use it with a new window instead of the virtual root. All right, so let's get a bit deeper on the xlivebg project. My goal with this project is not necessarily to make it an end-all, here's a list of hundreds of wallpapers you can use for the end user, but rather to be something like Screen Saver, but for live wallpapers. So basically provide the frameworks for third-party developers to write live wallpapers. And the main point, the main thing is that in order for this to work is that I have to make it extremely easy for someone who knows about graphics programming, but doesn't necessarily have a deep knowledge of the X Window system or wants to get into all the intricacies that we've talked about, make it really easy for someone like that to write a simple effect and have it be a live wallpaper. So, in order to do that, the main design pillars of xlivebg is that I should handle all the interactions with the X Window system. There should be zero lines of X specific code in the live wallpapers themselves. Okay, and a reminder here, live wallpapers are basically OpenGL programs, right? So the OpenGL context creation should also be handled by xlivebg, because there are some intricacies there as well, in order to create a correct kind of pixel format during the OpenGL context creation that will work with whatever window the window manager have created as the virtual root or the root window itself. So I don't want the wallpaper code to have any sort of logic for choosing the right pixel format or whatever. I want for live wallpapers to be simple, as simple as possible. Just start, initialize, and provide a function that draws whatever it needs to draw on the wallpaper. And also, the system should provide a number of helpers, like handling configuration, handling interactive configuration that changes that the user should be able to do while the wallpaper is running, to configure and change and tweak stuff, and provide helpers for common tasks like, I don't know, loading background images and creating OpenGL textures for them or whatever. Tasks that pretty much every live wallpaper is going to use, to avoid code duplication and simplify again the wallpaper code itself. So the basic design of xlivebg is like this. We have the main xlivebg program, which you can see here, and the live wallpapers themselves are actually plugins for the xlivebg program. So you compile your live wallpaper as a shared library, you put it in a specific directory where xlivebg looks for plugins, and when xlivebg starts up, it loads every plugin, initializes it, and can present a list to the user of the available live wallpapers there are to choose from. Also, very important, because as I said, I wanted to be able to change and tweak wallpaper settings on the fly, and settings about the xlivebg system itself. It also provides a pipe through which it accepts a number of commands for changing configuration options, switching, many things, like changing the active wallpaper, changing parameters of the active wallpaper, and so on and so forth. And at the moment there are two programs. There is a command line client which connects to that Unix domain socket and sends commands to the xlivebg. And actually, it's xlivebg itself. The binary, the program looks at argvimi then and acts as a command, as a client when its name is xlivebg-cmd. And there's also a GUI program that I'm going to show you in a second. Okay, so the main part of this is the configuration files. There are a number of search paths where xlivebg looks for configuration files, and it picks the first one it finds. It's not like cascading style sheets or whatever. It's just the first one that it finds, it uses. So if there are no user configuration files, it goes and uses the global system-wide one. But the idea is that the user would copy the global configuration file to their home directory and make any changes they want. And the configuration files have this format. It's a hierarchical configuration where you have, on the first level, you have the global settings, which could apply, but doesn't have necessarily to be used by any live wallpaper. For instance, the choices of how their background image should fit on the screen, or which background image should the live wallpaper use. Not necessarily applicable to all wallpapers, but common enough. And obviously, which one is the currently selected live wallpaper that we want to use. And also, for each wallpaper, there can be a section with parameters for that wallpaper. And the main point here is that the xlivebg system itself doesn't have to know what properties each wallpaper wants to use. The live wallpaper plugin asks for a specific property, and if it's present in the configuration that the xlivebg system has read from the user configuration file, then it provides the value to the wallpaper. Otherwise, it can use a default value or whatever. And at any point, any wallpapers can be written with any sort of parameters at all. However, to enable the use of a UI for configuring the live wallpapers on the fly, which, as I said, there is a Unix domain socket, all right, which is at tmpxlivebg.soc. And there's the command line client, which can send these commands to change configuration options or whatever. So in order to enable the xlivebg system to create a UI for the options of every live wallpaper without necessarily knowing what live wallpapers there are and what options each wallpaper has as a compile time thing, The live wallpaper plugin itself provides a list of properties. Not necessarily, but it can provide a list of properties that are tweakable things in the wallpaper itself. And this has this format, this hierarchical format as well, with each property having an ID, a description, a type, and other optional things like ranges for numeric types, or the type of the type of file names or whatever, the type of paths, let's say. Okay, so based on that now, we have the configuration UI program that I talked about previously. This also communicates through the socket and sends commands, but it presents an interactive UI to the user to tweak settings and change wallpapers or whatever. The left side of this configuration tool are the general settings, which, as I said, apply to any wallpaper, and also the wallpaper selection is part of it. And there are also the currently active plugin settings, which are derived from the property list that the plugin has provided to the system. And this is generated automatically from that. And settings that are done through this UI are immediately visible to the user. And in order to save the current configuration, the user has to click this button that sends the command to the xlivebg system to save the current settings to whichever file it read the configurations from. Okay, so there are a number of bundled wallpapers that come with version 1 of xlivebg, and I'm just going to show them to you very quickly now. Okay. All right, so this is the configuration dialog that I talked about. The first one that I showed you before is a color cycling wallpaper. It shows color cycling images, and you can choose whichever one you want here, because there are special kinds of images and not the general type of background images that you can use with anything else. There is the ripple wallpaper, which does ripples wherever the mouse pointer moves, and can also have raindrops falling on your desktop. There is a distort, which has many different options. I'm not going to show you everything here, because there is a better video that I have created, and it's available on YouTube, where you can see all the details of how this works. And there is a video wallpaper, which can show, which can loop a video clip on the wallpaper, and a stars plugin that creates a star field. And you can change the speed of the stars and their size and their color or whatever. All right, so let's get back to the slides. And as I said, this is not intended to be everything. This is intended as a framework, and these are sort of sample wallpapers that come with it, and the user can use until someone else writes more of them. And here's how you implement a plugin in this system, a live wallpaper. Basically, the plugin has to fill in this xlivebg plugin structure with its name, a description, the frame rate that it wants to draw at, which should be kept as low as possible, if at all possible, and the number of callbacks, like an initialization function, cleanup, start, stop, which are called when a plugin is activated or deactivated, a property function that is called whenever something changes in the configuration. This is how the interactive configuration system notifies the plugin that something has changed and needs to reread its parameters, and the draw function, which is the heart of the thing, because this is the one that gets called all the time continuously to redraw the background. And every plugin has to provide a register plugin function, which is opened by xlivebg for every plugin it finds in its plugin directories, and it's called to register the plugin to the system and make it available to the user. And this is actually the whole of a very simple live wallpaper. These two pages. This is literally the full source code. This is the implementation of these functions. We have some sort of initialization that possibly looks for specific parameters. We have the start function, which does whatever needs to be done when the plugin is activated, the property change function, and the draw function, which we can see here is able to utilize a number of helpers from the xlivebg API itself. For instance, it needs to get the number of screens that are available on the system, because this is important to know how many times it needs to draw for its display. And also some helpers like clearing the screen based on the options that the user have set, like which color to use behind the effect or whatever. It's up to the wallpaper plugin itself whether it wants to use those things or not, but there are a number of available helper functions in the xlivebg API. And this is the whole thing. So that's mainly what I want to talk to you about today. Here are a number of links. This is the website of the project. And in this website, you're going to find a complete manual with full instructions on how to set it up and how to build it and how to use it, plus an API reference. There is the GitHub repo. The xlivebg is released under the GNU General Public License version 3, or any later version at your option. And you can find the source code there, and you can send me bug reports or feature requests or whatever. And this is the video I've been talking about. If you want to see more details about how to actually, this video goes through the whole process of setting xlivebg up and configuring the various plugins, showing the plugins that are available right now and their settings, and it's a very nice introduction to xlivebg itself. Thank you for your time, thank you for watching, and I'll be glad to answer any questions that you have.